It's actually supposed to go to black, but I don't know why it didn't. Let's pray together. Father, I pray that you'll open our eyes spiritually. I pray that our hearts will be receptive so that your word can come and make the necessary changes in each of us. I pray, Father, that we will have faith because faith represents the eyes of the Spirit, and it is with faith that we see. So I pray that your word will go forth today and that lives will be changed in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, the Gospel of John movie actually just goes verse by verse through the Gospel of John, and I think it uses the Good News Bible. I'm going to read the entirety of chapter 9 of John, and I'm going to use the New Living Translation. So you'll see that we're going to cover some of that material once again, and then we're going to extend beyond that. Now, I'm not going to go verse by verse through John 9. We're going to do that on Wednesday, not this Wednesday. We're a little behind on Wednesday where we are on Sunday. I'm going theme by theme and scene by scene through the Gospel of John on Sunday morning, and we're going verse by verse on Wednesday. We went all the way, the rest of the way through John chapter 6 this last Wednesday. We'll start 7, but we're eventually going to get verse by verse in 9. But today we're going to talk about spiritual vision. And Jesus, I believe, healed this man, and I think the text will bear it out, as a way of demonstrating that he came to bring spiritual vision to people that are blind spiritually. This is chapter 9 of John in the New Living Translation. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man who had been blind from birth. "Rabbi," his disciples asked him, "why was this man born blind? Was it because of his own sins or his parents' sins?" "It was not because of his sins or his parents' sins," Jesus answered. "This happened so the power of God could be seen in him. We must quickly carry out the tasks assigned us by the one who sent us. The night is coming, and then no one can work. But while I am here in the world, I am the light of the world." Then he spit on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud over the blind man's eyes. He told him, "Go wash yourself in the pool of Siloam." Siloam means sent. So the man went and washed and came back seeing. His neighbors and others who knew him as a blind beggar asked each other, "Isn't this the man who used to sit and beg?" Some said he was. Others said, "No, he just looks like him." But the beggar kept saying, "Yes, I am the same one." They asked, "Who healed you? Well, what happened?" He told them, "The man they called Jesus made mud and spread it over my eyes and told me, 'Go to the pool of Siloam and wash yourself.' So I went and washed, and now I can see." "Where is he now?" they asked. "I don't know," he replied. Then they took the man who had been blind to the Pharisees, because it was the Sabbath that Jesus had made the mud and healed him. Isn't that fascinating? This man was born blind. He's healed. And they're concerned about the fact that Jesus made mud on the Sabbath in order to heal him. Wow. They are spiritually blind. The Pharisees asked the man all about it. So he told them, "He put the mud over my eyes. And when I washed it away, I could see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man Jesus is not from God, for he is working on the Sabbath." Others said, "But how could an ordinary sinner do such miraculous signs?" So there was a deep division of opinion among them. Then the Pharisees again questioned the man who had been blind and demanded, "What is your opinion about this man who healed you?" The man replied, "I think he must be a prophet." The Jewish leaders still refused to believe the man had been blind and could now see. So they called his parents. They asked them, "Is this your son? Was he born blind? If so, how can he now see?" His parents replied, "We know this is our son and that he was born blind, but we don't know how he can see or who healed him. Ask him. He's old enough to speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders who had announced that anyone saying Jesus was Messiah would be expelled from the synagogue. That is why they said, "He's old enough. Ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind and told him, "God should get the glory for this because we know this man Jesus is a sinner." "I don't know whether he is a sinner," the man replied, "but I know this, I was blind and now I can see." "But what did he do?" they asked. "How did he heal you?" "Look," the man exclaimed, "I told you once. Didn't you listen? Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too?" Then they cursed him and said, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but we don't even know where this man comes from." Why, that's very strange, the man replied. He healed my eyes, and yet you don't know where he comes from. We know that God doesn't listen to sinners, but he is ready to hear those who worship him and do his will. Ever since the world began, no one has been able to open the eyes of someone born blind. If this man were not from God, he couldn't have done it. You were born a total sinner, they answered. And are you trying to teach us? And they threw him out of the synagogue. Now, this doesn't just mean one time only. This man was healed by Jesus. He now could see, and they excommunicated him from the synagogue, which was a much bigger deal than if your church excommunicated you today. Verse 35. When Jesus heard what had happened, he found the man and asked, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" Now, Son of Man is a way of saying Messiah. The man answered, "Who is he, sir? I want to believe in him." "You have seen him," Jesus said, "and he is speaking to you." "Yes, Lord, I believe," the man said, and he worshiped Jesus. Notice Jesus didn't stop him from worshiping. Then Jesus told him, "I entered this world to render judgment, to give sight to the blind, and to show those who think they see that they are blind." Some Pharisees who were standing near heard him and asked, "Are you saying we're blind?" "If you were blind, you wouldn't be guilty," Jesus replied. "But you remain guilty because you claim you can see." Wow. It's quite a story. But I think that the end of the story is giving us the purpose for Jesus healing the man. Now, obviously, healing somebody is a good in and of itself. Here's a man who was born blind and now is healed and now is able to see, and that stands on its own legs. But why does John include this miracle in the seven? Remember, John's gospel is organized around seven major miracles, and they become increasingly powerful and overwhelming. Okay, the previous two miracles we saw were back in chapter 6, where Jesus fed 5,000 people with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, and where he walked on the water. That was miracles number 4 and 5. This is miracle 6. Miracle 6, Jesus heals a man born blind. Each of these miracles has a purpose. It has a meaning that goes beyond just the miracle. Well, the primary meaning is that they're all signs, and they point to the reality that Jesus is the Son of God. But Jesus is trying to demonstrate that just as this man was born blind, so are we born spiritually blind. Now, many people in Jesus' day, let's just talk about the physical blindness that this man had. Many people in Jesus' day believed that sin was the cause of blindness, and you can see that in this chapter. They believed that if you were in some way handicapped, or if you struggled with some sort of a malady or illness or whatever, that it was very likely sin that caused it. Now, sin can cause problems in our lives. That is certainly true. In fact, the last major healing that Jesus did was in chapter 5, where he healed the man at the pool of Bethesda, and he told that man, you need to stop sinning or something worse may happen. So that man had obviously put himself in the predicament because of sin. But here Jesus clearly says, no, this man is not blind because he sinned. He's not blind because his parents sinned. What does he say, in fact? He contradicted their belief. And in fact, the man's blindness was intended so that God's works might be seen in him. So here's the question, just a little application before we move on. Do you struggle with some kind of weakness or illness or handicap? Have you ever asked, well, God, why did you do this, or why did you allow this? Okay. I think that you can apply the same statement that Jesus made here to yourself. This is happening in your life. Perhaps you brought it on, perhaps you didn't bring it on, but it is happening in your life so that God's work may be done in you, so that God's works may be seen in you. Consider someone like the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul probably struggled with a problem related to his sight. And that problem related to his sight went back to the Damascus Road experience, where he was a Pharisee and he was arresting Christians and he wanted to drag them back to Jerusalem and he wanted to condemn them. He wanted to imprison them. He wanted them to suffer for saying that Jesus was Messiah. And so on the road to Damascus, where he had letters to bring Christians back, he was struck down by this bright, overwhelming light. And he heard the voice of Jesus say, "Paul, Paul," or at that point his name was Saul, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And Saul responded, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus whom you're persecuting." Well, he got up and he had to have people lead him into the city of Damascus by the hand because he was blind as the result of that light, that overwhelming light. Sometime later in Paul's life, he tells the Corinthians that the Lord has given him some sort of a, he calls it a thorn in the flesh. And he's prayed for God to take it away, but God hasn't taken it away. But here's what he heard Jesus say to him. That is Paul, who was Saul. He heard Jesus say to him, "My grace is enough for you, because my power is made perfect in your weakness." So in other words, Jesus was telling Paul, this affliction that you have asked me to take away is going to stay. And Paul said that it was going to stay because it was a way to keep him humble because of the overwhelming visions that he had seen, spiritual visions that he'd seen, right? God said, "My grace is enough for you. My grace is sufficient for you, because my power is made perfect in your weakness." What is your weakness? Maybe it's not a handicap. Maybe it's not an illness. Maybe it's an addiction. And you've prayed for God to take it away, and he hasn't taken it away. I have heard testimonies in the lives of people who have struggled with various addictions. I can tell you one testimony of a man who was addicted to heroin. In fact, he was introduced to heroin by his brother when he was only 11 years old. I made a little movie that was inspired by this. And from the time he was 11 until he was in his early 20s, he was completely addicted to heroin. He came to know Jesus, and that addiction was taken away. Now, that doesn't mean that he didn't struggle with the desire to relapse, because I am aware of a number of times in this same man's life that he relapsed. However, God did, in fact, instantaneously take that away, right? That happens sometimes. Sometimes somebody that struggles with alcohol, the Lord just takes it away. Sometimes somebody that wants to quit smoking, the Lord just takes it away. But more often, what happens? More often, you have to work through it with the Lord holding your hand. And he says to you, "My grace is enough for you." You're weak. Confess it. Admit it. You're weak, and you need me. You know, that's what's behind the AA movement, right? Alcoholics Anonymous, okay? Or if you go to another meeting for another addiction, they may just call it a 12-step program. There's Narcotics Anonymous and so forth. But what's behind that entire movement is this idea that your life has become unmanageable and you can't do it yourself, and so you rely on a power greater than you to bring you out of it, right? Now, they just say higher power. There's really only one higher power, and that's the Lord Jesus, and we identify him, okay? So whatever it is that you're struggling with, God wants to work in your life, just like Jesus said that God allowed this to happen to this man because he wanted his work to be done. Whatever's happening to you, God will work. God will work to make you into a new creation, even if he doesn't take away whatever the malady or the affliction or the addiction is. Now, I mentioned the Apostle Paul's his weakness, his thorn in the flesh, he called it. Many interpreters think that it was a problem with his sight, with his vision, that he had a hard time seeing. So that would apply to this fellow right here, right? All right. So we need to, Jesus said in verses 4 and 5, we need to work while his light remains in the world. Let's go back and take a look at those two verses. And this is how we start understanding that this is about more than physical sight. Verse 4, we must quickly carry out the tasks assigned us by the one who sent us. We must work now, is what Jesus is saying. The night is coming, and then no one can work. But while I am here in the world, I am the light of the world. Where the gospel is prevalent and where the gospel is preached, there is power to do the works of God. Where the gospel is persecuted, where the gospel is absent, the power of God is also absent. When Jesus is present, the power of God is present. When Jesus is absent, it is also absent. Well, what happens here is the devil blinds the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the truth of the gospel. That's what the Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4:4. He said, he's talking about religious people, actually, and he said, in whose case, in the case of these religious people, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelieving so that they will not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. People can be very, very religious, but they can also be very, very deceived. In fact, in the previous chapter, in John 8:44, Jesus is talking to religious people. He's talking to the Pharisees, and he says this to them, you are the children of your father, the devil, and you love to do the evil things he does. He was a murderer from the beginning. He has always hated the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he is consistent with his character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Pastor Craig covered this last Sunday. You see, this idea of spiritual vision, spiritual sight, is a metaphor or a way of looking at the truth and being able to, or willing to receive the truth or know the truth, which in the previous chapter also, Jesus has said, you will know the truth and the truth will make you free. But how will you know the truth? He said, if you are my disciples, then you will follow my teaching and then you will know the truth and the truth will make you free. Spiritual sight is an inability to recognize the truth. Or perhaps it could be said, it is an unwillingness to admit the truth, right? So the devil blinds the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the gospel. The more the deceiver shades the sun, the less able we are to do work in the lives of other people. So we point to Jesus. The reason that I've chosen the Gospel of John for this year is because I wanted to be very centered on Jesus, very focused on Jesus. That's how the power comes into your life. That's how healing comes into your life. That's how transformation comes into your life, right? It is through following Jesus and paying attention to Jesus, and that's why the deceiver, the devil, the enemy, wants to lie and turn people aside from the biblical Jesus. So some people will say that faith is blind. Have you ever heard people talk about blind faith? Right? These same people might say something on the order of, well, I'll believe it when I see it. I don't go after that blind faith stuff. But the reality is, faith is not blind. Faith, in fact, is sight. Faith is confidence or reliance or trust in someone or something that is trustworthy, right? We have all sorts of voices in our world today, right? There are all sorts of sources of news. I don't know if you're aware of this because it was like a whirlwind and it wasn't covered in mainstream media very well, but there was actually an attempted coup in Russia. Did you hear about this? This fellow named, I want to say his name is Prigozhin or something like that, is a military leader in a paramilitary organization called Wagner. I don't know if you pronounce it like it's German or not, but it is essentially, you know, a paramilitary organization that Russia uses to do a lot of its dirty work. And this guy got offended, and so he brought all of his paramilitary soldiers and started marching on Moscow to the degree that Putin left Moscow. Well, it really was difficult to tell exactly what in the world was going on. In fact, we really don't know right now exactly what went on, because the guy got 120 miles outside of Moscow and brokered some sort of a deal with Belarus, right? A neighbor of Russia, and then turned his column around and went back. Okay, well, we don't want to shed Russian blood, so we're going to go. But, it, you know, it depends on what news source you pay attention to as to how that's interpreted and what you think really happened. And we don't know. We don't know what happened. You trust a particular news source. And this is why I really advise people not to just settle on whatever your news source that you typically pay attention to, Fox, CNN, MSNBC, NPR, I wouldn't trust any of them. What we have to do is we have to get news from various sources and kind of parse it ourselves and pray through it ourselves and think through it ourselves and realize that they all have an agenda, okay? So this gets back to this idea of trust, okay? You trust a particular person. You trust a particular source. And that's faith. Faith is not blind. Faith is a matter of, okay, do I have good reason to trust this particular person or this particular source? The Apostle Paul said, "For we walk by faith and not by sight." So I believe it would be better to say, seeing is not believing. Believing is seeing. Do you understand this? All right. The man born blind was submissive, listened, and obeyed Jesus, and so he was healed. We don't have an indication that this guy had any faith in Jesus or any knowledge of who Jesus was. I think that the Gospel of John movie had it well. Did you guys see the cutaway, the faces of the disciples when Jesus spat in his hand and was making a mud pie? I mean, isn't that what you would do? I'd be, But just picture this fellow, right? He's sitting there, he's begging, and he submits to this. There's some reason that he trusted Jesus because he submitted to that. He let this dude spit in his hand. Now you say, well, he couldn't see. He could hear. And then Jesus rubbed this saliva mud on his eyes. He let him do it. He submitted to that. And then Jesus said, go wash in the pool of Siloam. This actually, I'll talk about this when I go verse by verse through this, but this pool has actually been excavated. It's right outside the temple grounds. It exists, right? And it is a pool. The name Siloam means sent. Isn't it interesting that he was sent to the pool called sent? And he did what Jesus said. He could have gone somewhere else and said, I'm getting this mud out of my eyes, right? This is gross. But he went to the place that Jesus told him to go. Nobody led him there. He was close enough to the pool that he probably knew where it was. Folks that are blind have more capacity, more capability than you and I who are sighted might give them credit for. And he did exactly what Jesus told him to do. And because he submitted to Jesus, he listened to Jesus, and he obeyed Jesus, what happened? He was healed. He could see. I want you to imagine this. You have never seen anything ever in your entire life. You've never seen the light of day. Can you imagine what that must have been like? That must have been incredible, right? So that's what he did. The scripture says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of Christ. Whenever you hear the gospel preached, whenever you hear the word of God, there's always the opportunity for you to open your eyes, spiritually speaking, and to believe. So here's my question then. Do you believe in Jesus? Do you believe in Jesus? You believe he's the Son of God? What have you done about it? What are you doing about it? Well, the scripture says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, what? You will be saved. Have you called on the name of Jesus? Have you invited him? I mean, actually done this with your own voice, called on the name of Jesus to save you. Sometimes we talk about praying a sinner's prayer. Calling on someone is talking to them. Calling on God is praying to him. Have you actually prayed, Jesus, I believe in you. I believe you're the Son of God. I open my life and I invite you to come in and take over. Now you can pray a variety of different sorts of prayers. I open my heart, come into my heart, all of these things. But have you actually said that? I mean, have you actually said that? Not just listen to some preacher talk and presumed that because you were listening, you prayed. Listening to me preach or pray is not the same as believing or praying. Have you actually called on the name of Jesus to save you? Believe with your heart, confess with your mouth, and so are saved. If you have you been baptized? Have you been baptized by immersion since you called on the name of Jesus? Well, yeah, I don't know if I want to do that because it's just kind of weird and religious, and I'm just not into that. But Jesus commanded it. Jesus told his disciples, go into all the world and make more disciples. Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have taught you. Jesus commanded people who believe in him to be baptized. Have you been baptized? If not, why not? If not, do you really believe? These are just real basics. Now, those of you that you've called on Jesus, you've been baptized since you were saved, do you take a stand for Jesus in the world? Or do you just stay quiet? Do you shine your light and let other people see that? Or do you hide it under a basket? Do you allow yourself to be the salt of the world? Or do you just sort of keep to yourself and stay away from people? Or worse, do you just go along with the crowd and laugh at their jokes and allow their blasphemy into your life? Friend, if we have faith, if we believe in Jesus, even the kind of faith that this man had, then we're going to be willing to take a stand. Now, you heard the rest of chapter 9. The guy didn't even really know who Jesus was, and yet he was taking a stand for Jesus in front of these Pharisees who were calling him names and eventually kicked him out. But he said, no, you know what? I don't know if what you're saying about this guy is true or not. I don't know if he's a sinner or not. But I know this. I was blind and now I see. And when Jesus said, do you know who the Son of Man is? He said, no, I don't know who that is, Lord. Son of Man is a term that is used for Messiah or Christ that goes all the way back to Daniel, the prophet Daniel, chapter 7, verse 14. Jesus' favorite title for himself in the Synoptic Gospels, that is the other three that are not John, is Son of Man. It was a way of him saying that he was, in fact, the Savior. So Jesus offers this fellow the opportunity to believe. And the guy said, well, I don't know who that is. And Jesus said, I'm the one. And he said, then I believe in you. And he worshiped him. He took a stand for Jesus. Are you taking a stand for Jesus? That's something that we need to do in our world. Our world is in desperate need of that. Okay? The Pharisees thought they had insight. These are the religious people. Okay? But the reality is they were spiritually blind. That's the concluding verse of chapter 9. They ask Jesus whether he's trying to say that they're spiritually blind. And Jesus said, if you were blind, you wouldn't be guilty. If you were really blind, if you were really ignorant, if you really didn't know, then you wouldn't be guilty. But you remain guilty because you claim you can see. See, they claimed that they had spiritual insight, but the reality was they were spiritually blind. There are plenty of people in church today that are the same. They claim to have knowledge. They claim to have insight. They claim to have right doctrine, if you will, and yet they're spiritually blind. But this isn't just isolated to church. Look at the two sides. There are many today who would call themselves woke. and they believe that they know the truth. They know the way the world is, but they're really spiritually blind. Some of these even seek to make Jesus the mascot of their godless ideology, but they're far from the truth that he embodies. Jesus might well say to these, as he said to the Sadducees, "You are mistaken since you do not understand the scriptures nor the power of God." Conversely, on the other side, there are plenty of people on the right, on the religious right, who hold to a form of godliness but deny the power thereof. That's 2 Timothy 2, 3-5. They acknowledge Jesus with their lips, but their hearts are far from him. That's from Matthew 15:8. They believe and teach, I don't know what, patriotism or politics, okay? But they don't follow Jesus or the teaching of Christ. These may even have right doctrine, but they're dead right since they have no love for those who disagree. We are to speak the truth in love. That's what the Apostle Paul said in Ephesians 4:15. Jesus might well say to these, "But go learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." Can you tolerate people who believe differently than you? Even if you really, really believe they're wrong, can you love them? See, you may be right, but you're dead right because you're alienating and rejecting people whom God loves. And the reality is, when we enter into dialogue with other people who think differently and believe differently than us, well, as the scripture says, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. When you enter into dialogue, even debate, debate doesn't have to be unhealthy. It doesn't have to be ad hominem. That means you're attacking that person. Debate can be healthy. Debate can make you stronger. It can make you figure out why you believe what you say you believe. Or it may make you take a look at your supposed belief in a different light and make adjustments. And I could give plenty of examples of this, but I don't have the time to do so right now. So whom do you follow? Jesus or something or someone else? You say, "Well, I follow myself." Well, then you're not following Jesus. The scripture says, and this is Jesus speaking again, Matthew 15, "If a blind person leads a blind person, both will fall into a pit." So who are you following? The Apostle Paul had to rely on his friends to lead him into Damascus because he couldn't see. If you're blind, you need a spiritual guide and you need Jesus to heal you. So what is the cause of spiritual blindness? Well, the reality is we're born spiritually blind and we have to be healed. Just like this man was actually physically blind when he was born, you and I are born spiritually blind. But I would say that the basis of spiritual blindness is unbelief. And you can choose, even after a childhood of attending Sunday school or going to a youth group and so forth, you can choose to become spiritually blind as the result of unbelief. So what you and I need to do if we want to be healed is we need to turn to Jesus, that's repent, turn from our selfishness and our sin, and turn toward Jesus and let him heal us. We need to put our faith in him. Spiritual sight, spiritual vision. Friends, it's what you and I need today if we're going to get through the world. The world is a dangerous place. It's becoming more dangerous by the day. And I said this going all the way back to the pandemic. You remember the pandemic 3 years ago? Yeah, hard to forget, right? We were scared to walk out our door. Maybe you weren't. A lot of people were. Okay. And I told people, you need to pay attention to the guidance and the leadership of the Holy Spirit so that you'll know how to stay away from places that you should stay away from. Friends, there's a mass shooting every other week right now. Have you noticed this? And yet people will just blindly go and attend, a mass meeting of people here or go do this there. I don't think that you need to stay inside and stay scared, but I do think you need to have spiritual insight and you need to pay attention to the Holy Spirit. I believe the Holy Spirit can keep you out of those jackpot situations. I really do. Before you make plans, before you make these big decisions, even before you make small decisions, okay? Yeah, I'm going to jump in my car and I'm going to drive down to such and such, or, I'm going to change jobs, I'm going to change houses, I'm going to change spouses, whatever it is. Before you make these decisions, you need to pray through it. And you need to pray that the Lord will open your eyes so that you can see what's going on out there. Amen? And, if you're scared, I can leave you with one story from the Old Testament. The prophet Elisha, he was the successor of Elijah. He was inside his house, and he had a helper with him, a servant with him, and there was an army that surrounded his house because he was speaking prophetically, and he was telling his king, the king of Israel, what to do to stay away from another king's army. So the other king heard that he was speaking prophetically and sent his army to surround Elisha's house. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine sitting inside your house and an army surrounds your house? That would be kind of scary, would it not? Elisha wasn't scared. Why wasn't he scared? His servant was scared. And so Elisha prayed. He said, "Lord, open his eyes so that he may see that those who are for us are more than those who are for them." And Elisha's servant's eyes were opened. And you know what he saw? He saw the armies of God surrounding his house. I'm telling you what. If you fear God, you ain't got nothing else to be afraid of. You need spiritual sight so that you can stay out of jackpot situations and so you can stay encouraged and so God can show you how he's loving you and how he's helping you and how he's protecting you. We need spiritual vision today more than we've ever needed it before. So I pray that you will allow the Lord Jesus Christ to open your eyes. We're going to sing a couple